Concepts of programming languages. In this video I want to talk about control structured programming or structured programming, basic control structures and operational semantics. So let's get started. First of all, let me zoom out a little bit so that you can get a bit of an overview of what we have seen already and how this fits together. And so you could understand programming languages by seeing certain paradigms. Some languages take different approaches and have different styles of writing down a program. But since most programming languages, or since the intention of every programming language is to compute, if a programming language is Turing complete, it can express anything that is computable, they're in some sense equivalent in what they can express. So why have these different paradigms evolved? Well, the reason you could argue is that certain styles and certain approaches are easier for certain problems. So if you have a problem that is well fitted to one domain, then you can use a particular style. Now, this used to be the case before, but nowadays, so in the past decade or so, most programming languages most of the actively developed programming languages started to converge. They now all include concepts that are part of different paradigms. So this distinction is mostly an interesting distinction from a historical perspective. And nowadays, within a single programming language, you could see different parts of the programming language that suit a different style better. Okay, so one way to make a distinction between programming languages is their approach to how to deal with input and output. And so there are two main approaches you could identify. The first would be what is called declarative programming. And if you think of a program taking some input and producing some output, then declarative programming can best be understood by asking yourself the question, does my programming language allow me to express in a simple manner what is the output? And then typical concepts involved in declarative programming are that you talk about, for instance, problems or parameters of problems or queries like you do in databases, or that you talk about the notion of a solution to a problem or answers to queries and maybe certain strategies of finding certain solutions. And what is now the point here is that you give a description of what is the proper output. And then you let the machine figure out how that output is arrived at. On the other hand, a different approach to dealing with input and output are the so-called imperative programming languages. And in imperative programming, the question you ask, how did I obtain my output, is central. So it is not what the output is, but how you have obtained it. So whenever you deal with concepts like tactics or commands, or you test things, or you are performing changes step by step, and you want to control the flow of, say, a program, then you're dealing with an imperative approach to specifying how an input results in some output. So orthogonal to these approaches, you could say, are then the composing styles of programs. So one already dealt with previously is that of functional programming. So you compose functional programs out of functions. So you take a function, another function, and you compose them, for instance. So that is the main way to construct your programs out of functions. And then, as I explained in the previous video, there is this notion of partial application, applications of functions. And later on, we will also look at how, for instance, recursive functions work, or how you can write them. different composing style is control structured programming. And in control structured programming, the way you compose program elements together to form a program is all surrounding the concept of control flow. You execute command by command after one after another, and you want to direct in what direction the control flow goes. And there is this notion of feedback. I mean, as soon as you have executed part of the program, then whatever you obtain then is fed back, and then you start maybe looping or iterating. Now, why do I say that these two, declarative and imperative programming, is orthogonal to the composing style? Well, it turns out that even in functional programming, you can write imperative programs. And even in control-structured programs, you still have the notion of declarative programming. For instance, by declaring what are the procedures that you could call, and then later on you can make use of those procedures. Then you don't know how the output is obtained, but you say, hey, I have some procedure somewhere, and I have declared it there, and I now want to use it. So these approaches to input-output and the composing styles are freely combined. So, but I will later in future lectures come back to, for instance, how in an imperative language you could work with procedures, or how you could implement maybe recursive functions. That is now for not the issue. What is the issue is that I want to show you control structured programming. So control structured programming, actually in the literature it's typically called structured programming, but that I think it is better to call it control structured programming, because it's really centering this notion of control, of controlling the flow of execution. Now control structured programming is surrounding the notion, so the central notion is, what is the command? What do you give to the computer? You give it instructions. And if you recall one of the previous lectures, you could imagine a computer that performs calculations step by step. But then maybe sometimes you want to divert control to a different part of the program, depending on certain tests. So this is important in if you do control structured programming. Now these commands they all can be understood as the command is looking at the state of the machine, and then the command inspects the state. It maybe performs a calculation, changes the state, and then it continues with executing the next command. But now, what is the next command? That is the question. Now the flow over time of which commands are executed, you want to gain some control over that flow. That's typically called control flow. Examples of structuring these commands in which you can direct the control flow is the structures are called branching structures or iteration structures, loops, feedback loops. And in this video I will show you very concretely how these control flow structures, at least basic control flow structures, work. Now a historically very influential language which all centered around this control structured programming is ALGOL. It's an algorithmic language. And from that point on, this style of composing programs was also employed by other later programming languages. Some examples of programming languages which very much embody this idea, this style of composing programs, is for instance the C family of languages. So that includes C, C++, the Go language, but also the Java family of languages. which includes, of course, the Java programming language, but also C Sharp. And for example, the Python programming language. And these are typical examples of control structured programming. Okay, so let me go into the details a little bit. But before, if you want to know where this structured or control structured programming actually came from, this is a nice article written by Edgar Dijkstra, in which he basically defends and explains why structured or control structured programming is useful. And in this video, I basically explain what he writes in that article, but then in more modern terms, you could say, use a simplified representation of it. Okay. So what are the basic control structures? Well, for that, before I introduce them, I want to simplify matters a bit so I can explain it a bit easier. And for that, I want to separate the notion of control, of control flow, and data. So you could imagine that you have a program and you execute commands in the program one by one, and that a command can then choose what next command to then execute. Now, if we separate out control and data, then what that means is that the program text itself is not considered to be data. So you cannot have that the program can inspect its own structure. Right? This simplifies matters a lot when I explain how it works. And the commands work on a state, and that state then can be modified. Now, this only talks about the program variables, but it does not change its own program. And so we will in this video not consider self-modifying programs, although they are very interesting, but that's the simplification that is done here. Now, you could ask yourself, okay, but why would you separate control and data? Because the whole point of the von Neumann architecture, which modern computers are still using, is to put them together, to put programs and data both in the memory. Yes, that is indeed the case. But what you could think of is that you have an operating system that indeed loads the program in a special segment of your memory. So indeed that then the program can be executed by the processor, but furthermore that we protect such memory regions where the program is stored so that we cannot accidentally modify the program while we execute it. And so that allows us to implement the separation of control and data. Okay, so what are the basic control structures? I will name a few of them. There are, of course, more, but these are the most important ones. There is the notion of a primitive command. So this represents a capability of the machine that executes the program that is somehow built in. For example, you could change the state of the program variables. This is a built-in operation that the machine could perform. Or you could imagine that you have some basic input and output that the machine could perform. So, but besides the primitive commands, there are also the composite commands. And they're called composite because they are structured compositions of commands. An example composition would be the sequential composition, where you take a command and another command, and you first execute the one and then you execute the next. And the result is sequentializing the order in which commands is executed. But a different composite command would be a branching construct. A branching construct allows you to choose, based, for instance, on the state, what command to execute next. And then this allows you to implement, for instance, conditional execution of commands. If a certain condition holds, then execute such and such and such command. Or if this holds, then execute these commands, otherwise execute the other commands. And it allows you to implement composite commands is allows you to express, excuse me, express the iteration over the same sequence of commands that you have given. Eh? So for instance, you can imagine that you want to execute a sequence of commands while some condition holds. Eh? So that if you reach the end of a sequence of commands, that you then go back and you loop back and you cause a feedback of whatever state you had then. And that feedback, the state is fed back because the control and returns to a previous position. And then the same commands are possibly executed again and again and again, and causing a looping structure. Okay, so these are some basic control structures. And we can introduce a grammatical a grammar for these constructs. So in this grammar, we see that we have a number of primitive commands. You could imagine a command that does nothing, the no operation or the skip command. You could have a primitive command that just prints somewhere on a peripheral device, say the resulting value of some, say, integer expression, and then prints it out. You could have a primitive command for changing the value contents of variables, so that is called an assignment. So in this, on the slides, I write down the assignments with this colon equals, but in some programming languages, again, the syntax can differ. So you sometimes see just only an equal sign. That's what's done in C, for instance. And then we have the composite commands. So for instance, you could, if you have C, C both being commands, then you could sequentialize by saying first execute the first part and then execute the second part. And you can have the conditional branching command if some condition that has to be evaluated in a particular state appears to be true, then execute this sequence of commands that is put within the braces. And otherwise, you don't execute those commands. And you can do looping with while some particular expression evaluates to true, execute this sequence of commands. And after executing the sequence of commands, then loop back and evaluate the condition again. You most likely have seen these structures, these control structures. So to explain in a more detailed fashion what is the meaning of these commands, I want to give you an example. So this is an example that involves the assignment primitive command and the print primitive command. And it furthermore involves this looping construct, the while loop. So what you see on the left is an example program that consists of a sequence of commands, and the commands are sequentially composed. So in this composition, you see that we make use of the sequential composition. That's the semicolon. And on the right, you see some working space that represents the state of the machine. Now the main idea of structured programming or control structured programming is that it is possible for us to know where we are in the program if we keep track of what are the commands that we have executed before. And then this position in the program text, where you are, you can call a control point. That's a point where the current execution is at, so to say. And to uniquely know where you are in the execution, it's also important to understand that since we have these while loops, we can execute that multiple times to keep track of how many times a particular loop that you are involved in has been executed. And if you know the position in the program, so which is the current command, and surrounding the current command, all the loops, you also know how many times you have already went through that loop, then you have a unique position in the execution of that program. And this was the main idea of Dijkstra, that you should structure your programming language so that you could understand with this information that there is a unique point in the execution. Now, to illustrate to you how these control points work, let me give you a run through of this simple program. And we start whenever we want to execute this program at the beginning. So that's the control point, huh? This is a black dot. So let's say we start with executing the first command. It's an assignment command, which then assigns the expression, which is a constant zero, to the variable x. So if we have executed this command, then because a sequential composition then says, okay, you have completed the command on the left of the semicolon, now continue with the command on the right of the semicolon. Okay, we do so. So after we have executed the first command, then our control point moves to the next command. And furthermore, the memory of the computer is updated so that we keep track of the assignment. So the value assigned to the variable x is zero, and we keep track of that. So the next command to execute in this case is to assign the constant value 5 to the variable y. Okay, so we can do that, and we can then move control to the next command. Okay, so we have updated the workspace. So at this point in the program, we're about to enter the while loop for the first time. Our memory contents is represented by an assignment of the variable x to the value 0 and an assignment of the variable y to the value 5. So now, before we can enter the while loop, we need to evaluate its test. This is called a test. It's the expression that is now here in parentheses. It tests whether this condition holds. And if that is the case, then we may enter the while loop. And if it is not the case, then we may not enter the while loop. Well, in this case, this expression, it's not a constant expression, because inside the expression, there is an occurrence of a variable y. So we have to evaluate this expression with respect to our current state. And our current state assigns 0 to x, and it assigns 5 to the variable y. So if we want to evaluate the expression here, hey, for that we can use the evaluation function that you have seen in the previous video. We basically plug in the value 5 for the variable y, because that's currently in our state assigned to y, and then you see 5 bigger than 0. Well, and that relation holds. 5 indeed is bigger than 0. So the test is true. The test is positive, so to say. So we may enter the while loop. So we enter the while loop. Our control point moves to the next command. And now the next command is an assignment of the variable x with the expression on the right-hand side. And if you look at the expression, it now involves the variable x and the variable y. So to evaluate the value of this expression, we look at our state and we see, oh, x is assigned 0, so this means 0. And then we have the plus operator, and y is assigned 5. So then we have 0 plus 5, which it's evaluated to 5 itself. So we now have an assignment of x to become 5. So if we execute that command, we change our memory. We change the state to let x be assigned to 5, and we move the control point to the next command. So that's why we are here now. Okay, so this command is an assignment in which we assign y to the expression y minus 1. So we look into the current state, and we see, hey, y is assigned 5. So here we can understood this y to stand for the current value of y, which is 5. So this means 5 minus 1, and that is defined to be 4. So y is assigned the value 4. So if we execute then this command, indeed, y changes, the value of y changes and now becomes 4. And the next command is to be executed. But what is the next command? We reached the end of the while body. And in the case of in the case you reach the end of the while body, what do? We loop back. So now we're back at the while command again. But this is the second time we're there. So now we have to evaluate the test again. So we have to test whether we may enter the while body. Okay, so now we have a new state. Because we have updated x and y inside the body, we have basically a feedback of the state. And now we have the new state in which we evaluate the test, whether we may enter the while body again. Okay, so this y now, in the previous time, it had a different value, but now we have to see it with the new state. In the new state, y is assigned 4, so then we can check 4, is it bigger than 0? Yes, the test is positive. So we may enter the while loop. Okay, so now we are inside the while loop. And now we can perform the assignment. We can evaluate the expression x plus y. X is 5. So we could see as if here there is a 5. Then we have the plus and y is 4. So we hear a 5 plus 4. 5 plus 4 is defined to be 9. So whenever we execute this assignment, 9 is the new value that is assigned to x. So that is then what we get. And we move to the next command. Now, again, we decrease y. So whenever we execute this assignment, then y is decreased by 1. It becomes 3. And we reach again the end of the while body. Now, we loop back while we have this new state again. And we can re-evaluate the test. Well, y now, this time, the third time that we execute the while loop, y is 3. 3 is again bigger than 0. Okay, so we may enter the while. We may enter the while body. X is 9, y is 3. 9 plus 3 is 12. So x becomes 12. 3, we decrease it by 1, becomes 2. So y is 2. We reached again the end of the while body. Then we loop back. we evaluate the test again. Well, 2 is positive. Okay. Enter the body again. 12 plus 2 is 14. So we update x. We decrease y again by 1. So y becomes 1. Reach the end of the while body. We loop back. This is the fifth time that we have been at this position. So we can again enter the while body. We do 14 plus 1, which becomes 15. We decrease y by 1, so y becomes 0. And we loop back. The sixth time we now are at this position. And now we check the test. The test is it the case that y, this time y is 0? Is it the case that 0 is bigger than 0? No. So it's a negative test. And we exit the while statement. So what do we then do? We continue with the command that follows the while. So we go to the print primitive command. Now, in the print, it evaluates the expression. In this case, it's just a variable. That's the value 15. And 15 is then outputted to some auxiliary device. So that is then the expected output whenever we then are done. So 15 is the final value of x. That is then printed. So this is very much showing you an imperative style, an imperative program. How have we obtained the output? You saw step by step what we did, and then at the end our output is 15. But now to contrast this with a more declarative approach, you could also say, well, how could you compute the outcome? And this was a formula that was given by Gauss, or at least so it is said. This is this story about Gauss, who was at elementary school, and then his teacher asked him to sum all the numbers from 1 until 100, and then he recognized a nice pattern, and he could immediately compute it without doing all the work. Well, that's the formula shown here. So y in our original state was 5. So we do 5 times 6 is 30 divided by 2 is 15. So that declares immediately what is the output that you can expect. And so here we have program that shows you how to obtain the result. And here you show a formula. Here you see a formula that shows you what is the result. Okay, so that is then an example of these basic control structures. Now, operational semantics is a way of giving meaning to programming languages. And you have already seen denotational semantics, and we have made use of denotational semantics in evaluating our expressions that occur within our programs, arithmetical expressions, Boolean expressions. So now operational semantics is a different way of giving meaning, namely to these commands, programs that are sequences of commands. And an operational semantics can be understood as sort of abstractly describing how a machine is performing step-by-step operations. And for that, we assume that the machine has basic capability. For instance, we assume that the machine can evaluate expressions. And then we use that whenever we take step by step, moving our control point to the next command. Now, an operational semantics consists, before I can explain what an operational semantics is, I have to explain what is the configuration in which the machine can be. You can understand a computer, a machine, to be configured. You could, for instance, load the program into the machine, and you can then say, okay, start executing at this command, typically the beginning of the program. You could initialize its memory, its data, with some with the values that the program variables have to have. And this is a configuration of the machine. So the machine is initialized by giving it, you can understand that by putting it in a certain configuration, and now the machine operates. You can imagine it has maybe as a mechanical machine has some kind of way of maybe driving the machine or running it over your, letting it run your program. So you put the machine in an initial configuration, and then the machine transitions from a configuration to the next configuration, to the next configuration, to the next configuration. And most likely, the program that it operates then on remains the same, but the control point in the program, so that is the current command that it should execute, can change. And moreover, the state, for instance, of its memory can change while it transitions from configuration to configuration. So an operational semantics describes the meaning of a program in terms of such an abstract machine that transitions from configuration to configuration. So to give you a bit more a concrete example of how we operationally understand our simple programming language given before, these programs that are then textually understood by the grammar consisting of these commands, composite and primitive commands, we can understand the meaning of such a program in terms of how such a machine would transition from configuration to configuration. Okay, so let's have a look at what the initial state or the initial configuration of the machine has to be. Well, we load the machine with a program. So that is part of the initial configuration. What is the program? We choose the control point to be the beginning of the program, the first command of the program. And for all its program variables, so the state of the program variables, we just choose random values. We don't really care about the program variables. But you could also imagine that to be given also. So this random is arbitrary choice. And then this is the first configuration of the machine. And then we start running the machine. We start operating the machine. And then the machine moves from the initial configuration to the second configuration, to the third configuration, to the fifth configuration, etc. So, and this relation that you can understand as moving from configuration to the next configuration. Okay, how does that work? Well, we can define such a relation, for instance, by looking at how these commands should change. What if the current command, the command that is indicated by the control point, is for instance a skip, then what should be the next configuration? Well, that is schematically shown here. So suppose that the configuration has some program, so I use these dots to represent whatever the program is, I don't care about the rest of the program, but suppose that the control point stands at the skip command, and the current working space, so the state of the machine is some arbitrary assignment of program variables to values, sigma, and then we can understand this as a configuration, and then the next configuration is, well, we move the control point to the next command. And we leave the state of the program variables, the state which assigns program variables to values, the same. Because the skip does not do anything to the state. But it moves the control point to the next command. Okay, so that is the skip. It's a simple one. What if the current command would be a print? Well, in this case, suppose that we are in a configuration where our current control point points at the print command, and our state, say sigma, that represents the assignment of program variables to values, that is our current configuration. What would then be the next configuration of the machine? Well, we execute the command, we do not modify the state, but we do move the control point to the next command. And as a side effect, the machine on some auxiliary device prints the value that you obtain by evaluating the expression E that is in your program under the state sigma. So under the current state of the machine. And under the state that is in the current configuration of the machine. Okay, so then you can observe maybe some printout. Okay, good. What is the next command that we should try to understand? Well, that's the assignment primitive command. So suppose that you have the control point stands at the assignment command and our current state is sigma. Then what is the next configuration? Well, we now do two things. One, we change the state, and two, we move the control point to the next command. But how do we change the state? Well, the new state, so sigma prime, is obtained from the old state, sigma, but now we update the value of the program variable, so the variable that occurs in the program here, x, by setting it to the value you obtain by evaluating the expression e under the old state, sigma. So the old state of the machine influences what the new state of the machine will be by evaluating the expression E in the old state. And so we then have effectively changed the value assigned to X. Okay, so that is an assignment. What can we do with, for instance, the conditional composite command? So suppose that we are in our control point, and you haven't seen this in the example yet, but we can still reason about it. So we suppose that we have the program, so there is something before it and after it. So suppose our current control point points to a command which is an if. So this is a conditional command. So the if will evaluate the expression. And if that evaluation in our current state of the machine happens to have evaluate to true, then we don't modify the state of the machine, but we do modify the control point and we go inside. Yeah? So we go into the sequence of commands that is grouped by this conditional if command. Okay, so then we basically move in the if whenever the expression evaluates to true. But now what happens if we reach the end of the if body. Well, in that case, we just move to the one, the command that follows the if command. And so we just move on, we just continue that way. Now, this is different whenever we deal with the while command. Oh no, before we go to the while command, what happened if in our if we reach in a control point, the control point is at the if command, and we evaluate the test, E, but the test is not equal to true. Well, in that case, we immediately jump over the whole if body, and we continue with the next command. Okay, so now consider the while. So how does the while work? Well, suppose our control point reaches the while. Then we evaluate the test, and if the test is true, then we enter the while body. And now there we could continue execution of the body, and then at some point we will reach the end of the while body. Then what do we do? And this is different than the if. The while is a loop, so we basically loop back, taking the state that we had at the end of the while body, and we move that to the beginning. So we are now again, for maybe the second or third or nth time, at this while command. Okay, and then, well, we could evaluate, for instance, E again. And then if it's true, we enter it again, as you have seen in the example. But what if we have that the test is not true in our state? Well, then we just skip over the whole while and we continue with the command that follows it. And that is similar to how the if works. So in the if, whenever the test is not true, then we just skip over the whole body and we continue with the next command. Okay, so that gives you an idea of how we operationally understand or give meaning to programs that consist of these commands. Okay, so an execution of a program now can be understood as a sequence of configurations of the machine. Such that the first configuration is the initial configuration by loading in the program. And then for every pair of consecutive configurations, so you have two configurations that are succeeding each other in this sequence of configuration. For every such pair of successive configurations, it must be the case that the relation holds between them. So that means that the second configuration is obtained from the first in this sequence. Well, and then you call the resulting sequence an execution of the program. That's how you understand executions of programs. Operationally. Okay. So you might ask yourself the question, is there also an operational semantic for the lambda calculus? Then we can understand expressions in the lambda calculus as programs. And then what is the way we could do step-by-step calculation? And what are the configurations of such a machine? And how do we see executions of such a machine? Well, there are different kinds of operational semantics you could give. Now, the one you have seen in last week, you could see that it would be a self-modifying program, because you can take the program, the lambda expression, and then if you recognize somewhere there's you can perform, for instance, an alpha conversion, or you can recognize somewhere there is, for instance, a reducible expression. So there is this application on the left-hand side, abstraction, so that you can beta reduce that. Then you could move by rewriting the program, so self-modifying program, and then continue. So this is not what we considered before, because we said, no, we don't want to change our program. So there are also different techniques for how you can keep the program, so the lambda expression, fixed, and then how to define an operational semantics for it. But that is not part of this course. So that is an advanced topic, and you can study that maybe later. Okay, but it is in principle this is doable, and you can give an operational semantic also for the lambda calculus. Okay, now could you not swap the question? Is there not maybe a denotational semantics for the programs? I mean, you have now seen an operational semantics that give meaning to what these programs mean, but can we not denote what is the value of a program? And that's also a very interesting topic. It can be done, but it's an advanced topic that is dealt with in other courses. So we will not do that here. But it is, again, you can also give denotational semantics to the programs you have seen before. Okay, that's this video. Thank you for watching and hope to see you soon again.